So hello, how are you guys? Good, all right. A happy belated Women's Day. It's for all you women out here, all right. And let's begin. So this is a presentation on Latin America and Eastern Europe is an overlooked opportunity. This presentation is brought to you by LACE, which is Latin America, Caribbean, Eastern Europe Association. I'm one of the co-founders, as well as these two beautiful women right here. And all right, let's begin. So, before the political system changed, during the socialist regimes back in the 70s and 80s, Eastern European countries had enormous economic contacts with Latin America. They were more intense than what it is nowadays. Eastern Europe exports was promoted through state loans, state-owned companies, and export to Latin American countries. Eastern European countries had embassies and other representatives' offices in almost all of Latin America. After the political change during the 1990s, the number of these representations was significantly reduced. So, how can we begin? So I'm gonna start off by talking about the diplomatic, economic, and cultural ties that Eastern Europe has had with Latin America over the past couple decades. The initial relations with Latin America began in the 16th and 17th century. They first began with migrants from Eastern Europe, comprised mostly of Czechs, Hungarians, and Polish, in the form of Jesuit priests. So in keeping with Latin American traditions, you have Jesus and you have beer. So political ties didn't begin until the late 19th century. This was after the Latin American countries started. rebelling against the Spanish crown, and Eastern Europe started rebelling against Prussia, Austro-Hungarian Empire, and the Russian Empire. Now coming toward World War I and World War II, these countries started balkanizing. So they started getting away from these empires. Latin America hosted a lot of these exiled governments into Latin America. So during both World Wars, Latin America coasted, maintained relations with many of the exiled governments. However, in World War II, the world order changed. So you had Team Freedom, and then you had Team Comrade, as you can see. Then came 1959, and this marked the rapprochement of Latin America. This marked the rapprochement of Latin America into Eastern Europe. Why? All thanks to Fidel Castro. Hashtag Team Compadres. Trading cooperation was strong between Latin America and Eastern Europe, primarily through Yugoslavia and Soviet initiatives. This translated into bilateral agreements comprised of trade, technical assistance, and in some cases, military assistance, as you saw with the Cuban Missile Crisis, obviously. and this time, Latin American Caribbean Eastern Europe cooperation also saw a rise in cultural exchange. Students and professional exchange led to modernization in industries in Latin America, and the development of Latin American studies in Eastern Europe was crucial to diplomacy and trade. Actually, when I was in Serbia, I met this guy. He was one of the commanders of the merchant marines for the Yugoslav military, and he told me that every single time, all the trade was basically from Eastern Europe to Latin America. Also around this time, Eastern Europe diasporas had a profound impact on Latin American country and society. Polish communities, which there's a ton of in Latin America, received Pope John Paul II, which he frequently tripped over there. Orthodox churches were built. Politicians, even of East European ancestry, even became presidents. As you can see with the former president of Brazil. Do you guys know where she's from? Besides Brazil, obviously. Half Bulgarian, half Bulgarian, can you believe it? So, why Latin America and Eastern Europe? Geography is a crucial subject. However, general reductions in transport costs offers new opportunities for economic and social interactions. Both Latin America and Eastern Europe are generally comprised of middle-income countries, which means it's kind of like the middle class of global economy, and thus have greater growth potential than high-income countries such as the U.S. or Germany or our European Union as a bloc. Direct investment is currently low, but overall growth projections for the GDP is very much favorable for investors. So, why Latin America and Eastern Europe? Both regions expect a 3% growth overall. Romania is positioned to be the fastest growing economy in Eastern Europe at 4%. The Dominican Republic, where my family is from, is expected to grow at 5% and accounts for 22% of the GDP of all Central America and the Caribbean. So if, while you investors out here, if you guys want to invest in some great property, some nice beaches, come to the Dominican Republic. If you guys want to go see Dracula, go to Romania. So, but you have to figure, but you have to take these two. You have to take these two regions. You have to take these two regions and fit them in the global chain. So, how can you do this? Latin America is one of the largest producers of commodities in the world. We own about 40% of all copper, about 20% of the gold, and roughly around 30% of zinc, and of course of other minerals that are important with advanced technologies that we see now, in cell phones, laptops, and so and so. Countries such as Poland, Hungary, and Latvia, and even Russia, already have or are in the process of drafting initiatives in Latin America. Multinationals with global value chains are paramount. Connecting Latin America and Eastern Europe into these networks allow for increased production and cuts costs. Large multinationals and even small and medium enterprises from Latin America have moved their headquarters to cities within Eastern Europe that require little to no taxes from foreign businesses. So for them, this grows their profit margin and also allows them to grow their market share within Eastern Europe. For example, Hungarian tech company Graphisoft took over its Mexican counterpart. They're allowed to bring their products from, again, Eastern Europe, and grow their manufacturing and grow their output within all of Central America and the Caribbean. Polish mining giant KGHM absorbed Canadian Mining Corporation to become one of the largest extractors in Chile, which in Chile is the largest producer of copper, and also I think I want to say is the second or third largest in silver. So, how do you guys incorporate these two regions together? It's called synergy. Latin America offers an important growth market potential for Eastern European countries. Brazil and Colombia have large military sectors that need modernization. Mexico and Chile have several free trade agreements with Latin American countries, as also with the United States, and allows for Eastern European countries to gain new regional markets. Brazilian manufacturer Embraer, which does planes, can be used for Eastern European Air Force modernization. As you know, they have a lot of old Soviet technology, and they need to modernize their military in order to combat the Russians. So, come to Latin America, we'll help you out with the Russians. The port in Slovenia and Latvia offer transport possibilities for Latin American countries and towards the Balkan and Central Asian region as well. Recent initiatives that they have done is Russia and Peru. Russia has done a few agreements with Peru, Argentina, and Brazil in the sectors of economic cooperation, military sales, investment in energy projects, and agricultural cooperation, especially after the sanctions that were imposed by the EU and also the United States. Peru and Romania have cooperations with education, science, culture, youth, and sports. Mexico and Latvia have a cooperation with culture and education and sports. Colombia and Slovenia, culture and education exchange. Same thing with Argentina and Lithuania, culture and educational exchange. So, what are the challenges? As you can see, Eastern Europe is all the way over here, and Latin America is all the way over here. All the ports that pretty much go from Latin America to Eastern Europe, they all either land in Hamburg, London, or in Rotterdam, which are the largest ports in Europe. So how can we get the Balkans to ship over here to Latin America? Well, given the geographical distance, as I showed, and lack of transport infrastructure, it's a key factor. 90% of global trade is through maritime. There's also a language barrier. If you go to, let's say, for example, the Dominican Republic, and be like, hey, do you know any Hungarians? Or they'll be like, what, Hungarians? You know, from Hungary. They'll probably be like, oh, no, thanks, I already ate. Something like that. You know, you say, for example, I told my mother I was in Serbia last month, and she was like, oh, my God. What are you doing over there? Like, it's so cold. Like, do you guys even pack up coat? I was like, no, mom, Serbia, not Siberia. She's like, oh, okay. But and then again, and the most important factor for me is mutual ignorance. And that's what it all comes down to. A lot of people in Latin America, they really don't know the geography of Eastern Europe. And similar, I guess I could say, with Eastern Europe as well. However, what I was surprised is that in Eastern Europe, there's a lot of Spanish is pretty much spoken by a lot of people, which actually was a surprise for me. If you go to Latin America, that's not the case. Not that many people know Polish, not that many people know Hungarian, not that people know Romanian, even though Romanian is a Romance language. So, what are the solutions? How can we fix this? Easy, cultural rapprochement. We need to once again build diplomatic relations with Latin America. We need to open up more embassies. We need to do more cultural exchange, because right now Eastern Europe is more focused on joining the EU. And to me, that is a little bit of an issue, because some countries there, they don't want to be in the EU. Another aspect is countries want to leave the EU. We had Brexit. You had the Greek financial debt crisis that was going on. If the elections go on in Spain, in France, you have France that will want to leave the European Union. This causes for a collapse of the economic market, and also it doesn't have, how do you say it? There's not that much confidence in the marketplace within Eastern Europe, within the European Union. Also with the United States in regards to Latin America, Donald Trump, he wants to renegotiate NAFTA. So what does that mean for Latin America? Well, it means that the trade you guys had before might not be there tomorrow. So you need to diversify your markets. You need to diversify your portfolio. You can't put your eggs all in one basket. For example, in the 1990s, Latin America pretty much was hit really hard after the recession that was going on in the US in the 80s. Now, in the recession that we just had in 2008, Latin America was pretty much unscathed. Eastern Europe wasn't the case. Eastern Europe was really facilitated with the European Union. And once the economic crisis hit European Union, all you saw was the currencies in Eastern Europe go down, you saw the market shares go down, and it's the same thing. So that's why after that, Eastern Europe started more focusing on the Asian market, whereas not really paying attention to Latin American markets. And the same thing could be said as the Asian market, as China is pretty much within a bubble. Again, reciprocal diplomatic visits. There's a tendency where diplomats go to Latin America, they enjoy the beaches, and they just don't come back. Same thing with Latin America. They visit Estonia, for example, or Latvia or Russia, they're like, oh, no, it's too cold over here. I'm just going to go back to my beach. So you need to have this open friendship. You need to have this open relationship with Eastern Europe because we actually have a lot of things in common. We need to attract skilled workers, tourists, young professionals, and students with visa regulations. So we need to, lower the requirements of visas so we can attract investors and we can attract skilled workers. We need to promote your diasporas in your respective countries. For example, in Poland, there's a huge Polish diaspora. There's a huge Latvian diaspora. Lithuanian diaspora. There's also Ukrainians there. In Chile and all around the southern part of South America, there's people from Hungary. There's people from even Romania in some aspects. And for example, in the Czech Republic, we have a lot of Polish, a lot of Ukrainians, and also a lot of, who are they from? Oh, Russians as well. So we need to take those people and pretty much promote that, like, hey, we have your people here. You guys could come and you guys could integrate into our societies and into our skilled labor force very easily. And also, and more importantly, you need to promote your entrepreneurs. You can't just sit around and let your entrepreneurs wither around, because those are the people that actually do the contacts. Those are the people that actually go out and find new opportunities. Those are the capital ventures. And yeah. So, mi hermano, muy brat, fratello mio. Questions, comments, and or concerns?
Thank you very much, Josh, for your great presentation. And now, dear ladies and gentlemen, please.
Please, ask away. I'm here all night, basically.
Hi, my name is Rumbi. Are there any countries that you've identified as natural pairs for this Latin American EU?
Natural pairs? I would say that Romania is actually a really good natural pair because we both share a similar language. Again, Spanish is a Romance language, and so is Romanian. So as far as the language barrier there, it's not that difficult. Also in Romania, there's a lot of the population there, especially the young population, they grew up watching telenovelas, which is our Spanish soap operas. So they know Spanish actually at a pretty well level. So for me, I would say that those two countries are actually a really, really good pair. However, the trouble is finding the ports there, and as far as transportation. However, it's 2017, we're in a digital age. So as far as digital companies and IT and tech, those two can actually do pretty well together. Next question. No. Yes.
Hi. I'm Anya. I'm from Croatia. The one next to Serbia, posted. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Thank you for your talk. It was really great. I mean, I don't have anything to add. It was quite complete. But just another segment of the economy, like of the stuff that, for example, Croatia and Chile are connected. I don't come from the capital of Croatia, and even my hometown has a consulate of Chile, and like a specific consul, and also the Chilean wines, I don't know, Grgić, the ones that were burning in this January, actually, unfortunately, they're actually all Croatian wines that the immigrants brought to Chile from Croatia after the Second World War, because they were running from the communists. Didn't end up nice. I mean, no, I just like, it was like a comment, not like a question.
In the Czech Republic, there was also, if you heard in the news, I think it was like a couple months ago, where Cuba had to pay their debts to the Czech Republic through a rock. So there are long-lasting relations within Latin America and Eastern Europe. However, those relations are very close, but this. So as far as the economy is speaking, in a more broader sense, it could do a lot better. But yes, Chilean wine, actually, wines, cigars, those type of foods over here that Eastern Europe actually very popular. Everybody wants Cuban cigars, everybody likes American cigars. Why? We make some of the best wines in the region. So, yes, I
agree.
Good evening. My name is Adam from Belarus, which is a central part of Eastern Europe, and you never tell anything about Belarus. And the case is a relationship between Belarus and Venezuela is one of the examples. Do you know anything else about Belarus?
As far as the trade relations between specifically with Belarus and Venezuela, is that what you're asking? Specifically with the trade within Belarus?
Yes, yeah. Any potential?
Well, Venezuela is in obviously a tough situation. They haven't updated their economy to fit the global markets. So what you're seeing now is that obviously it was a socialist regime and it kind of came back to bite them. There are some countries in Latin America that have this one big issue that's kind of making investors nervous, which is countries that are predominantly either socialist or pink, if you would say, they have this tendency that if a company is doing very well, they'll nationalize. So Venezuela was very, very, they were habitual, they just did that a lot. For example, I think it was BP that they nationalized a couple of years back. But they have this issue where they take a company and they nationalize it so they make a game of rocks. However, that drives away investors. Because if I'm gonna invest in you, and you're gonna take my money and run, no, that's not very well. So what Belarus could do is go on to other countries that are more free market. For example, Central America, Caribbean. They're more adept to work with the United States, and there's certain regulations there that's already South America, depending on which country you're talking about, it could be a little bit risky investment. However, it is up to those people to actually come and do economic reforms that will fit the global markets. I guess it's the same thing with Belarus. I'm sorry, I'm a little bit ignorant on Belarus right now. But as far as if I'm pretty sure that you guys do more of a state initiatives, where you guys do state owns, do state corporations. It's actually a really good thing. It's a good starting point. However, you need to be careful of which country you do business with, especially at this time. Because, for example, Brazil, same issue. Argentina, same issue. And Venezuela, same issue. So, if I was to suggest, for example, to Belarus and do investments there, I would go to more Central America, Caribbean, where they have economic structures that are more investor friendly and that will protect you even better.
Questions?
Yes. Hi, I'm Pablo from Spain. I would like to ask you, I don't know, there's no one trade agreement among all the Pan-American countries, Central America, South America, I don't know. And if it's affirmative, the answer, don't you, those contracts you made with the countries in Eastern Europe, don't you agree, don't you make them in like a team, like a group, in all the countries, or just individually? And the second question, if you don't mind, has nothing to do, but anyway. Do you where from, if you don't mind?
I was born in the United States, but my family's from America.
That is the reason, because you have the American flag.
I don't know.
Okay. Okay.
Okay, so the first question is regarding, as far as Central Americans and South America, they do have NAFTA, and they also have CAP. They have NAFTA, which is North American Free Trade Agreement, and they also have CAFTA-DR, which is a Central American Free Trade Agreement in the Caribbean Republic. Those are deals that have been already in place since the 90s. However, with this new president in the United States, that deal can be like a little, some on ice right now. As you know, he already canceled TPP. So with him coming, and he also wanted to renegotiate what's going on with NAFTA and CAF. So that kind of worries the market. The market doesn't like when stuff changes that rapidly. So that's why you need to diversify your, diversify your markets to other places. Right now, same thing with Eastern Europe wants to get into the EU. However, within the EU, you have to meet the regulations, so on and so forth, get on the euro if you want to get on the euro. But they open up the markets there. However, you have Brussels dictating exactly where you're going to sell and how you're going to sell. So, for example, if you have cucumbers from Brazil or something like that, or cucumbers from Argentina, you want to bring it to the EU, guess what? It's really hard to bring agriculture in there because they have specific regulations. A cucumber needs to be, for example, 6 inches, 7 inches, or however much that is in centimeters. And they won't allow that. So it makes trade a little bit more difficult. So if countries do either bilateral or kind of regional negotiations, so for example, there's the Bicep, which is the Poland, Czech Republic, Slovenia, and I believe it was Hungary. Those smaller trade blocks can facilitate business easier. Because when you have bigger, we have the more number of countries negotiating its trade, it makes things a lot easier. I mean, how many times have you guys gone to like have been hang out with your friends, you want to go grab something to eat, nobody can decide how to eat. So then you just end up going home hungry. Same thing. So when you come back and you hang out with your three best friends, what do you want to eat? Oh, McDonald's, what kind of Burger King, Wendy's is the same thing, let's go with it. It's a lot easier to facilitate trade back than it is with bigger multinational trade blocks like NAFTA and EU. More questions? Chile is in here.
Since you mentioned that NGO at the beginning, can you explain how NGOs can strengthen ties between the two regions, and especially this one?
Great question. Very great question. Well, again, you have to do a cultural reproachment. NGOs, state economic institutions, kind of need to broaden their horizons. Everybody, again, you guys have Erasmus here in Europe, because they want to have that European identity. However, again, with the situations that are going on in Europe, it would be worthwhile to invest your time in different countries. Yes, they're far away. However, the cultural aspect are very similar. If you go to Latin America, if you go to the Balkans, they're very much the same people. They're very open, they like to drink, they like to eat. Same thing in Latin America. You guys have barbecues, you guys have drink your cerveza, have fun, go to a party, and do those type of things. So I would say that NGOs in particular can kind of fill in the gap between state initiatives and state initiatives and market initiatives. The NGOs can have their own initiatives there, or they could be the facilitators between both state and private enterprises, because that's what NGOs are basically for. They're kind of doing that. So if there are more NGOs that are more interested within Latin America, hey, God bless them. And they should be pushing more to Latin America, because this is a really good market. They have a lot of growth potential. Actually, when the 2008 crisis was going on, a lot of Spaniards were actually going to Latin America because they couldn't find jobs in Spain. They already know the language, and all they had to do is just go there, build up an enterprise, and go work for companies there. Romania, for example, it wouldn't be that difficult to learn Spanish because, one, it's almost the same language, and two, a lot of Romanians already know Spanish. And it goes the same with the Balkans in general. But again, to keep it one thing in mind, this presentation is very general. I'm brushing a wide brush here. You know, so as more specifics, it could be tailor made to each country individually. Questions?
I would like to ask you one question. You already met many people from Eastern Europe here during your trip. So please answer to my question very, very honestly. Yes. Yeah, please tell me what is, as always, yes. Please tell me what is your opinion? What you would consider as the biggest weakness and also the greatest strength of the people of Eastern Europe?
Eastern Europe? Oh, you guys are very curious. You guys like to meet a lot of foreigners. You guys like to, if you were, let's say, for example, in Poland, you know, I'm a little bit brown, I'm like, oh, who's this guy? You know, so it's the same. So they're like more curious about people in general. Again, they're very hospitable, they're very open. If you go to a bar there, hey, come drink some rakia, come drink some vodka with me. You have no problems. Then, like for example, when I was in Poland, there was a guy there who was Russian, he was a Russian Pope, and he said I look like Ice Cube. I guess I do. He said I look like Ice Cube. That's the first thing I was like, I guess. You know, because it's funny because my friends say that I'm the American Ice Cube. So he took me to a Foot Locker, put a little Raiders hat on, took a picture, and we just got, you know, we just partied on for 2 or 3 days. The biggest weakness is, I would say, and it's gonna sound a little bit contradictory, but there are instances where in Eastern Europe, in general, are sort of closed. So, for example, if they don't know you, like if they don't know you, it takes a little bit of a while to actually kind of build that trust. Yes, you can drink for a night. However, the next day, you still my friend? Come on, please. So it takes a little bit to like build friendships and that type of matter. Economically speaking, again, they're both in the same range as far as economic goes. So it would be a natural fit for Eastern Europe to fit with Latin America.
Jen, final questions? Hi. Okay, so, yes, thank you very much,
no
Josh, for your great presentation.